In March 2022, 39-year-old Eric Eugene Richins passed away unexpectedly, leaving behind his wife Kouri and their three small boys. 1 year later, struggling to cope with the loss, Kouri wrote a children's book that dealt with the theme of grieving the loss of a family member. However, in a shocking turn of events, just a few weeks later, Kouri herself became the primary suspect in Eric's murder. But as with many true crime cases, there's much more to the story than meets the eye. Let's dive into the crooked case of the killer turned children's book author. Located in Summit County, Utah, Camas is 42 miles east of downtown Salt Lake City. It has a total area of 1.6 square miles and a population of 2,110, according to the latest U.S. Census. Its main industries are cattle ranching and lumber. This is where the Richins family resided, in a sprawling 5-bedroom, 4-bath home on Willow Court, valued at more than $1.1 million. Eric Eugene Richins was born in May 1982 in Bountiful, Utah. The Richins family is one of the oldest and most prominent families in Summit County. Eric's childhood was spent on his father's ranch, helping with tasks such as hauling hay, tending to livestock, and mending fences. Sports played a significant role in Eric's life as well, both as a fan and participant in activities including basketball, baseball, and soccer. As a father, he coached his son's teams, and as an adult, his love for the outdoors manifested in avid hunting trips. Eric was a devoted member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. He spent 2 years on a mission in Mexico City, during which he became proficient in Spanish. Back in the States, he earned his bachelor's degree from the University of Utah, majoring in international studies with a minor in Spanish. Leveraging his skills and determination, Eric established a thriving masonry business from scratch, known as C&E Stone Masonry. Kouri Richins, also hailing from Utah, was born in Eber City in April 1990. According to her LinkedIn profile, she earned a bachelor's degree in healthcare administration from Weber State University and holds a master's in human resources from Utah State University. Kouri has quite a diverse career background. In 2010, she started a housekeeping company named Kouri Darden Housekeeping Services. She also has experience working as a hospital administrative assistant and later as an enhanced patient services and specialty clinic trainer at Park City Medical Center. Most recently, she was active in the real estate industry as a licensed agent. Eric and Corey's story began at Home Depot, where Kouri was earning her living as a cashier. A colleague introduced them, and it didn't take long for sparks to fly, given their shared love of sports and their ambitious spirits. A few years down the line, wedding bells were ringing, and they pledged their love to each other on June 15, 2013. Eric had been through the pains of a lost spouse in a tragic car accident, making this his second chance at marital joy. However, Kouri was handed a prenuptial agreement by her future mother-in-law on her wedding day, which asserted that she wouldn't have a claim to Eric's 50% stake in his masonry business unless Eric died during their marriage. In the ensuing years, Eric and Kouri would welcome 3 boys, who are now ages 10, 9, and 6. The Richins, known for their sociability and warmth, were well-liked in their community, often venturing on trips and expanding their circle of friends. One old friend of Eric's, who had known him for about 20 years, recently commented that the Richins seemed to lead the perfect little life. Eric was the primary breadwinner in the family, while Kouri harbored lofty ambitions. Yet, their seemingly idyllic marriage began to wobble under financial strains just 3 years in, exposing a marriage mired in secrets, unwise financial choices, and escalating tension. In court documents filed on May 18th, prosecutors allege that between 2015 and 2017, Kouri obtained four separate life insurance policies on Eric without his knowledge, with a combined potential payout of $2 million. The plot thickened in September 2020 when prosecutors allege Eric discovered that his wife, the person he was meant to trust implicitly, had somehow obtained and spent a $250,000 home equity line of credit on their home in Camas without his knowledge. That was just the tip of the iceberg. Eric found that she had also withdrawn at least $100,000 from his bank accounts and racked up more than $30,000 in charges on his credit cards. Additionally, the court documents claimed that Kouri had misappropriated over $134,000 from Eric's business funds intended for tax payments. Eric confronted her about the stolen money, and she pledged to reimburse him. The following month, Eric sought advice from divorce and estate planning attorneys. Then, without Corey's knowledge, he rolled out a new asset protection strategy. Actions included modifying his will to exclude Kouri and assigning his estate to a living trust. He then appointed his sister trustee. In addition, Eric transferred his share of his business from Kouri to the trust and named the trust as the recipient of his $500,000 life insurance policy. According to family members, these aggressive moves were designed to protect the children's financial futures. Meanwhile, Kouri was equally determined to secure her financial standing, even if it meant employing less than ethical means. As alleged by prosecutors in an unsealed warrant, on January 1, 2022, Kouri brazenly logged into Eric and his business partner's joint life insurance policy with C&E Stone Masonry, removing them as co-beneficiaries and appointing herself as the sole beneficiary. Fortunately, the moves triggered an alert from the insurance company, and Eric and his business partner were able to reverse the changes. Not one to be deterred, Kouri allegedly tried her luck again just weeks later, starting a new application for a $100,000 life insurance policy on Eric, according to prosecutors. With Eric in asset protection mode and considering divorce, Kouri had few options to overcome her growing money woes. She was in a serious financial crisis, allegedly burdened by a multi-million-dollar debt. She reportedly owed at least $1.8 million to a hard money lender, nearly $200,000 to the IRS in back taxes, and $514,346 to her husband for money she withdrew from various accounts and spent without his consent. But not all hope was lost. Kouri stumbled upon a possible solution to all her financial problems. Kouri viewed the lavish, unfinished mansion in East Midway as a way to make a quick dollar and the possible solution to her financial stress. She was confident she could flip the 20,000 square foot property for a significant profit. Initially, Eric was open to the idea, and by early 2022, they were under contract for the property at $2 million. However, Eric eventually found the mansion too risky, leading to frequent arguments with Kouri. This property became a major source of conflict between them. Even though Kouri had initially convinced Eric to become a co-borrower, police records suggest that Eric's family believed he was convinced the property was a white elephant. As a result, Eric was about to tell Kouri he would back out of the deal. For Kouri, this would have been devastating news. On March 3, 2022, just 48 hours before the mansion deal was scheduled to close, Kouri spent her day in desperate conversations. First, she reached out to the hard money lender with whom she was deep in debt. Next, she spent significant time on the phone with the IRS. Finally, as the stressful day ended, Kouri made Eric a Moscow mule, which he sipped in bed as they retired for the evening. However, a disturbing twist awaited them. Kouri claims to have awoken around 3 a.m. to find Eric cold to the touch and unresponsive. She stated she immediately called 911 and frantically began CPR. According to a statement of probable cause, EMS staff responded to a residence at Willow Court at 3:30 a.m. on the report of an unresponsive male. When they arrived, they found Eric Richins on the floor at the foot of his bed. Life-saving measures were attempted, but Eric was declared dead. One of the paramedics requested the presence of the police at the scene, as he found the circumstances were suspicious. An affidavit states that Kouri claimed she attempted CPR on her husband, but when medics arrived, they said a large amount of blood came from Eric's mouth, yet they observed no blood on Kouri. It did not appear to the medics as if she had done CPR at all. When questioned, Kouri told officers she and Eric spent the evening celebrating the upcoming closing on the $2 million Midway mansion. At around 9 p.m., she made Eric a Moscow Mule, which he sipped in bed while scrolling through his phone. The Richins went to bed shortly after, but their night was briefly disrupted when one of their sons woke up from a nightmare. According to Kouri, she left their bedroom to comfort him. The next thing she knew, she woke up at 3 a.m. after falling asleep in her son's room. When she returned to her bed, she was taken aback when she came into contact with Eric and noticed his skin was cold to the touch. That's when she stated she called for an ambulance and started CPR. Investigators were perplexed. Faced with the unexpected death of a seemingly fit and healthy man, they had little to go on. Orders were given for toxicology tests and an autopsy in the hopes that they might shed light on the mysterious circumstances surrounding Eric's death. Meanwhile, amidst the ongoing investigation, Kouri stayed on course with her plans. Just one day after Eric's death, Kouri finalized the purchase of the $2 million mansion. She even threw a big party at her house, celebrating with her friends. In the 3 days that followed, she held another gathering at her home, hired a locksmith to attempt to access Eric's safe, which held up to $165,000 cash, and had a physical altercation with one of Eric's sisters. Following Eric's death, Kouri expected his $3.6 million estate to be split as per their prenuptial agreement. However, she was informed by Eric's sister that he had transferred his assets, including the family home and his masonry business, to a trust, and appointed her the trustee. Kouri also learned that she was removed from Eric's will and replaced by his sister as the beneficiary of his $500,000 life insurance policy, leaving Kouri financially unstable. Shocked and enraged by this news, Kouri assaulted her sister-in-law, leading to an assault charge to which she pleaded no contest. 2 weeks after Eric's death, Kouri had the mansion listed for sale with an asking price of about $4.8 million. The investigation into Eric's death took a sharp turn when detectives uncovered some startling facts. The autopsy results, paired with toxicology reports, revealed that Eric had succumbed to a fentanyl overdose. Moreover, the level of fentanyl in his system was staggeringly high, about 5 times the lethal dose. And this wasn't medical-grade fentanyl, it was the illicit type, the kind typically purchased in street transactions. Adding another layer to the mystery, the medical examiner concluded, based on an analysis of stomach acid, that Eric had ingested the fentanyl by mouth. Armed with this evidence, the detective swung into action, securing a search warrant for the Richins' home. They conducted a thorough sweep of the premises, seizing phones, computers, and any other items that might contain evidence. By May 7th, prosecutors believed they had developed sufficient probable cause to take the next step.
Well, Mike and Deanie, Kouri Richins is here in the Summit County Jail tonight. We're told she is being held without bail. Investigators say she purchased fentanyl and then served her husband a deadly dose in a drink. And court papers say this is not the first time she's tried to kill her husband.
On Monday, May 8th, 2023, 14 months after Eric's death, Summit County Sheriff's deputies arrested Kouri Richins. She was charged with criminal homicide, aggravated murder, and 3 counts of possession of a controlled substance with intent to distribute. Prosecutors believe Kouri poisoned her husband on the evening of March 4, 2022 by mixing a lethal dose of fentanyl into a cocktail she made for him before bed. According to the charging documents, they believe it is not her first poisoning attempt. The arrest came 1 month after Kouri appeared on local television to promote Are You With Me, a 41-page picture book she authored to help children cope with the death of a loved one. The book is described as a heartwarming and reassuring must-read for children who have experienced the pain of loss. Kouri claims she wrote the book with her three children as a tribute to their recently deceased father. Should the murder accusations against Kouri be substantiated, her television interview promoting her book will serve as a chilling and surreal display of deliberate deception and possible signs of sociopathy.
No matter if it's a parent, a sibling, or a friend, talking about loss with kids can be a tricky subject.
Joining us now is author of Are You With Me, Kouri Richins, to share her three C's to helping kids cope with grief. And Kouri, I want to start with your story. What happened in your personal life?
So my husband passed away unexpectedly last year. So it's March 4th was a 1 year anniversary for us. And he was 39. It completely took us all by shock. And we have three little boys, 10, 9, and 6. And, you know, my kids and I kind of wrote this book on the different emotions and grieving processes that we've experienced last year, and, you know, hoping that it can kind of help other kids, you know, deal with this and kind of, you know, find happiness some way or another.
And to make sense and process, I'm
yes.
sure, and I'm yeah. sure you felt that going mm-hmm. through and trying to explain it and articulate it for you and your boys.
Yes, exactly. And so I've done, you know, I'm new to all of this, so kind of doing, you know, research and reading books and things to try and understand, you know, not only how to grieve as a widow, as a wife, but also, you know, with my kids, how to help them understand what just happened. And what I have kind of found is, as I mentioned, it's kind of the three C's is how I has visualize it. And it's, you know, connection, continuity, and care. And it's, you know, making sure connection is the one major one, and making sure that their spirit is always alive in your home, you know, and memories are always brought up, and doing things that your loved ones love to do, whether it's riding bikes or their favorite dinner, and just constantly, you know, talking about them. And
Kouri, do you mention at dinner, here's Dad, or Dad would like this meal, or Dad
yes.
would,
yeah.
let's bring Dad on a bike ride?
Yeah, exactly. And it's, you know, explaining to my kid, just because he's not present here with us physically, that doesn't mean his presence isn't here with us, and he's doing these things with us, and he's, you know, here for birthdays, and he's here for Christmas, and, you know, and it's just comforting to them to know that, you know, they're not living this life alone.
One day after Kouri's arrest, Are You With Me surged into the top 5,000 of Amazon's top books list. Kouri told an NPR affiliate in Salt Lake City that there were plans for sequels, including her next title, Mom, How Far Away Is Heaven? The Utah news channel that conducted the TV interview later updated its story to say it had not been aware Kouri was a suspect in her husband's death. The book is no longer available on Amazon. The Summit County Attorney's Office in Utah filed an amended complaint against Kouri on May 18, 2023. In that six-page document, investigators claimed that detectives uncovered an inconsistency in one of Kouri's statements during questioning. She initially told officers that when she left her bedroom around midnight to go to her child's room, she left her phone plugged in next to her bed and did not bring it with her to her child's room. Yet, forensic testing revealed that her phone was locked and unlocked multiple times when she claimed to have been in her son's room. In addition, tolls on her phone show that several text messages were sent, received, and deleted during that time frame. In particular, investigators became aware of communications between Kouri and an individual with the initials CL. A police records check of CL revealed multiple counts of possessing a controlled substance with intent to distribute. CL was located and interviewed on May 2, 2023. CL told detectives that Kouri texted CL about an investor who suffered from back pain and needed pain medication. A few days later, they went to Kouri's residence and obtained some hydrocodone. 2 weeks after this transaction, Kouri contacted CL again, claiming the investor wanted something more potent. Kouri sent a text message asking for some of that Michael Jackson stuff, propofol. She mentioned that fentanyl would be ideal. CL replied they didn't have that medication, but knew someone who did. So on February 11th, 2022, CL and Kouri headed to Ogden to purchase 15 to 30 fentanyl pills for $900. 3 days later, on Valentine's Day 2022, prosecutors allege that Kouri made her husband a sandwich and placed it on the seat of his truck with a love note. After one bite, Eric broke into hives and had trouble breathing. He used his son's EpiPen as well as Benadryl before passing out. He recovered and sent a message to his friend that he thought his wife was poisoning him. In fact, Eric Richins had suspected his wife had tried to poison him multiple times. According to affidavits for search warrants obtained from the Summit County Sheriff's Office, he also warned his family that Kouri would be to blame if anything happened to him. According to one of Eric's sisters, Eric and his wife went to Greece a few years ago, and after his wife gave him a drink, he became violently ill and called his sister, saying he believed his wife had tried to kill him. 12 days after the alleged Valentine's Day poisoning, Kouri and CL returned to Ogden and purchased another $900 worth of fentanyl pills. 6 days later, on March 4th, Eric died of a fentanyl overdose. Kouri told officers that Eric had struggled with a pain pill addiction in high school, but that there had been no substance abuse issues since then. Friends and family told police they did not notice any behavior indicative of drug use, and no painkillers were found in the family home. A family spokesperson said Eric stayed in the marriage because he did not want to create a broken home for his children. As of the date of this video, Kouri remains in Summit County Jail with no bond set. Her detention hearing, originally scheduled for May 19th to determine a possible release, was continued due to amended charges filed against her. As far as the Richins' children, Oxygen reports that Eric's sister continues to look after them as their legal guardian. Meanwhile, Kouri is due back in court on June 12, 2023. As this case unfolds, the investigation has revealed a compelling mix of direct and circumstantial evidence. However, several questions remain, such as, why did it take a full year before charges were finally brought against Kouri? Will the direct evidence be strong enough to result in a conviction? How much of the hearsay evidence can be proven? Have conversations been had with those who attended the party? And perhaps most interestingly of all, what could Kouri's defense possibly be? As the case progresses, we eagerly await these answers. What are your thoughts on this case? Do you see it as an open and shut case of murder? Or do you believe there is a path to acquittal for Kouri? As usual, feel free to share your thoughts below.